promise that you'll never find another like me. I know that I'm a handful, baby. I know I never think before I jump. And you're the kind of guy the ladies want. And there's a lot of cool chicks out there. I know that I went psycho on the phone. I never leave well enough alone. And trouble's gonna follow where I go. And there's a lot of cool chicks out there. But one of these things is not like the others. Like a rainbow with all of the colors. Baby doll when it comes to a lover. I promise that you'll never find another like me.
I know you never get just what you see, but I will never fall you, baby.
And when we had that fight out in the rain, you ran after me and called my name.
I never wanna see you walk away. Cause one of these things is not like the others. Living in winter, I am your summer. Baby doll, when it comes to a lover, I promise that you'll never find another like me.
The world keeps changing, so my mission is turning challenges into opportunities. I'm opting in, signing up, and using my voice. Today, I recommit to my shine. For myself, for my community, for our health. There is strength in possibility, and new opportunities are coming. With the American Heart Association by my side, I'm ready to thrive. Because we live fierce.
180 over 111, and I had a stroke. I was diagnosed with high blood pressure 12 years ago. I had 6 mini strokes in the hospital, and I had a severe stroke 8 months later. That day was terrible. I passed out, and that's what I remember, passing out. When I woke up, I couldn't speak or walk. I felt trapped inside myself because I could think. I am an attorney and I can't go into the courtroom because I think that most people don't find me intelligent. They tend to finish my sentences. And that's what I want to do. You have to be an advocate for your health. Because if you don't take care of yourself, this is what will happen.
Nearly half of US adults are disproportionately affected by a silent killer robbing us of precious time with our loved ones. This silent killer causes many people unnecessary disease and death, and many don't even know they have it. A healthy blood pressure is below 120 over 80. The higher a person's blood pressure, the more forcefully blood is pumped through the heart, organs, and arteries, creating devastating consequences. It's often the first step towards strokes, vision loss, heart failure, heart attacks, kidney failure, kidney disease, and sexual dysfunction. At age 50, people without high blood pressure have life expectancy 5 years longer than those with high blood pressure. Even though high blood pressure can't be cured, it can be managed effectively through lifestyle changes like a well-balanced, low-sodium diet, managing stress, maintaining a healthy weight, and medication when needed. And while this may sound simple, there are many factors that can limit a person's ability to manage. Meet John. He was recently diagnosed with high blood pressure. Because his blood pressure wasn't measured accurately before, he's had elevated levels for much longer than he knows. John's doctor recommended that he regularly monitor his blood pressure, but his limited break schedule makes it hard to stay on top of. John lives in a food desert, without consistent access to healthy food that is low in salt. And the local market that has healthier options is much more expensive. John's high insurance copays have made it difficult for him to afford both his medication and healthier groceries, forcing him to choose less nutritious foods. All of these issues combined contribute to John's already high levels of stress. Because of where John lives, the local economy is struggling, affecting the whole area from limited low-wage jobs to underfunded schools. This limits John's ability to afford the means to provide better options for his family. The truth is, John's story is truer for some people than others. Women make up more than half of the high blood pressure deaths, with women of color being disproportionately impacted. Among Hispanic Americans over age 20, 50% of men and 40% of women have high blood pressure. Compared to white Americans, Black Americans are 40% more likely to have high blood pressure, 10% less likely to have their blood pressure under control, and 3 times as likely to die from heart disease caused by high blood pressure. The American Heart Association is committed to equitable health for all by reducing uncontrolled high blood pressure. We're working with partners to improve diagnosis and control in healthcare settings, supporting efforts that provide those in need with home monitoring services, working with community partners to ensure access to pharmacies and nutritious foods, and meeting people where they are to identify high blood pressure and connect them with clinical services. As champions for health equity, the American Heart Association and our volunteers are uniquely positioned to provide the systemic and policy changes needed to improve blood pressure control in high-risk neighborhoods, reducing disparities, because everyone deserves the opportunity for a full, healthy life.
As a federal law enforcement officer responsible for deterring human smuggling, I felt absolutely bulletproof when the doctors told me to change my diet, go on medication, lower my stress levels, and I didn't listen. You know, just because you feel great doesn't mean that there's not a problem. November 5th, I got off work, went home, and I was playing catch with my oldest son, and then all of a sudden I couldn't move my left arm. Turned out to be a full-blown major stroke. And then I had my second and third stroke and followed into a brain surgery to repair the damage. Very hard to imagine that I've been termed disabled. I've had to learn to swallow again. My memory is absolutely shot. The foot, I have no movement, zero. That's, yeah, head to toe, everything's changed. If I would have followed a treatment plan, I would not be in this situation. I was 40 years old.
Just another number, right? Think again. It can mean all sorts of bad things. Swimming is great, but swimming with 130 sharks is a bad idea. 130 is too much of a lot of things, and it's too high for blood pressure. A blood pressure reading of 130 over 80 or higher means you're more likely to have a stroke or heart attack. Visit heart.org/HBP to find out more about controlling your blood pressure.
Okay, let's have a real talk about blood pressure. Do you monitor yours regularly? It's something everyone with high blood pressure should do, but it's something most people don't know how to do correctly. Checking your blood pressure regularly will help let you know if you have it under control. It will also help you start to understand which factors are putting you at higher risk for stroke and heart attack. Before I get to that though, I just want to stress one thing. If you have high blood pressure, you should talk to your doctor to figure out how frequently you should be checking it at home. For most people, taking your blood pressure twice in the morning and twice in the evening, even just for a week, will help you and your doctor get a better understanding of your blood pressure. For morning readings, it's best to take those before you take your blood pressure medication. It's also very important to avoid exercise, caffeine, or tobacco at least 30 minutes prior to testing, since those can affect your levels. Now, let's move on to talk about the proper way to measure your blood pressure at home. Nearly half adults in the U.S. have high blood pressure and are at high risk for stroke and heart attack, so self-measuring is one of the easiest ways to be proactive about our health. Here I have my blood pressure monitoring device. It's easy to use, and it helps me get an accurate reading. Be sure to get an automated device with the upper arm cuff. That's the type doctors recommend. The first thing you want to do is find a quiet place to sit where your back is in an upright, stable position. A dining room chair is great. You want to make sure the chair isn't too soft so your body is fully supported. Sit with your feet flat on the floor and don't cross your legs or ankles. If you need to use the bathroom, make sure you go before you do your reading. Next, rest your arm on a flat surface with your palm facing up. Place the blood pressure cuff on your bare upper arm just above your elbow. Your arm should be relaxed and resting so the cuff is at the same height as your heart. Now rest quietly for 5 minutes before taking the first measurement. Avoid talking while taking your blood pressure measurement. Once your first measurement is completed, write down the blood pressure numbers and pulse that are displayed on the device. Wait 1 minute and then repeat this process again. As you just saw, it's important to check your two measurements at around the same time each morning and evening. At your next doctor's visit, be sure to share your blood pressure numbers so you can discuss the numbers and so your care plan can be changed if necessary. That's it. Not bad, right? Measuring your blood pressure at home is easy to do and a great way to stay on top of your health. If you have more questions about managing or measuring your blood pressure overall, visit the website.
Well, good morning, New York City, and welcome to the American Heart Association's 2021 New York City Hypertension Summit. It is a pleasure to be with you today. We want to thank our presenting sponsor, Centers Healthcare, and our advocate level sponsor, Columbia University Irving Medical Center. You know, we're in for a treat today as day one of our clinical track begins. And in just a minute, you're gonna hear from really amazing experts from around the country and from right here in New York City. First, we're gonna hear from Dr. Brent Egan from the American Medical Association, followed by Dr. Nupur Narula from Weill Cornell Medical College, then nurse practitioner Rosemarie Marion from Weill Cornell Medical College will join us. And then it's going to be Dr. Joseph Diamond from Long Island Jewish Medical Center, followed by Dr. David Borsheimer from Montefiore Einstein Center for Heart and Vascular Care. And finally, we'll hear from Dr. Mark Pecker from Weill Cornell Medical College. All right, now it's my pleasure to welcome our first speaker, Dr. Egan, Vice President, Cardiovascular Disease Prevention for the American Medical Association, Improving Health Outcomes. Welcome, Dr. Egan.
Well, thank you. It's again a delight to be with you today. Really appreciate the opportunity to speak at this excellent program that's been put together. I'll be talking about hypertension treatment algorithm. And I think as many of you know, our patients benefit when we choose and use one. So I'll present one. It's an example. There are others, but I think it's really important, as I'll try to share with you, to have one of those treatment algorithms that you can use. My disclosures are shown. Next slide, please. So the learning objectives, what I'd like to cover with you today is the purposes and advantage of having a standardized hypertension treatment algorithm, particularly for patients without major complications or indications for specific drug classes. listing the advantages of single pill combinations whenever we can use single pill combinations and decrease pill count, particularly if that can be done without increasing co-pays or cost to the patient, a very useful thing to do. And I'll try to share with you some of the evidence that that is the right path. Outline the benefits of prompt and sustained blood pressure control. Many years ago, we used to say start low and go slow with regard to controlling blood pressure. We've learned over the years that patients that get their blood pressure controlled in the first 3 to 6 months of treatment and then sustain blood pressure control over time, not oscillating back and forth in and out of control, actually do better, not surprisingly. And then something as clinicians we often don't think about, but the importance of the mean systolic blood pressure range required to achieve high and consistent control, whether we're aiming for less than 140 over 90 or less than 130 over 80, I think understanding the range this blood pressure needs to be in for high and consistent control, because again, that's where patient outcomes are better. Next slide, please. So I thought I'd start with a case. We'll come back to this case at the end. So I'll just show one slide to think about as we proceed through the next few minutes. But J.S. is a 48-year-old man, body mass index 32, and he's known to have prediabetes. An active individual, he's been asymptomatic, and he's not taking any medications currently. He has no personal history of cardiovascular kidney disease, but a family history of hypertension, diabetes, stroke, in chronic kidney disease. Dr. Shimbo talked about the automated office blood pressure. His average over the last two visits was 147 over 84. He did take home blood pressure twice daily, morning and evening for 7 days, average 146 over 86, as you see. On exam, his body mass index was confirmed at 32, his waist circumference 41, which is in the metabolic syndrome range for a man of 40 inches plus. He does have some target organ damage with some arteriolar narrowing and a soft fourth heart sound, suggesting again that this blood pressure is already affecting a target organ vasculature in the heart. He had a comprehensive panel, which was normal. His estimated glomerular filtration was 92, urine albumin creatinine 14, so within the non-microalbuminuria range, total cholesterol, triglycerides, HDL, LDL as shown, A1C 5.9, confirming prediabetes, EKG, heart rate 72, otherwise unremarkable, and his 10-year cardiovascular disease risk was estimated at 6.2%. In addition to lifestyle modification, we're providing some treatment options here. He's going to continue his self-monitored blood pressure and return in 1 month. And you decide because of his consistent elevations of blood pressure at home in the office to begin amlodipine, 5, once daily, amlodipine benazepril, 2.5, 10, daily, or amlodipine benazepril, 5, 20, once daily. And again, we'll come back to this at the end, but think about your answer now and then see if it changes as we go through the information. Next slide, please. Well, let me just share with you some modeling of blood pressure that was done and published in Circulation a couple of years ago, looking at the importance of patient adherence, the return visit frequency, and the frequency with which medications intensified for uncontrolled blood pressure. So assuming a baseline blood pressure control rate of about 46%, it was estimated that improving patient adherence to 100% from the estimated national average of 57% would raise blood pressure control about 11 percentage points, as you see, from 46 to 57%. If we kept adherence constant but reduced the return visit interval from an average of 14 weeks to an average of 1 week, again, about a 3.5 month interval between return visits in the country for uncontrolled blood pressure, reduced that from 14 weeks to 1 week, keeping the other variables constant, was estimated to raise blood pressure control about 20%. If we kept adherence and return visit intervals constant at 57% and 14 weeks, but improved intensification from 1 out of 7 to more than to 5 out of 8 visits or more, notice that blood pressure control would improve to an estimated 80% or higher. And clearly, if we were able to do all of these things, we'd be more certain of getting control rates in the 80% or greater range. Next slide, please. So again, the advantages of hypertension treatment algorithm, it helps us to ensure a high level of standardized care to achieve safe, timely, and sustained control of blood pressure. Some of the advantages are that having an algorithm that everybody on the care team knows about facilitates efficient care, improves communication with the patient, especially for the clinicians who are busy, which is the standard, and most of our patients which have many medical problems more than hypertension. For example, in the Medicare population, it's not unusual to have 10 chronic conditions. And even some of our younger patients have multiple chronic conditions. So having a hypertension treatment algorithm allows us to initiate and advance therapy more efficiently than having to spend time thinking about our treatment plans. Again, if we have advanced practice nurses or clinical pharmacists working with physicians and everybody's using the treatment algorithm, it's easier to engage other members of the treatment team in advancing therapy on an efficient schedule. It can also, if we have in-house pharmacies or community pharmacies, make sure that the medications that we're prescribing are available and affordable. And knowing what those medications are can help to be ensure they're in place, particularly if we're using single pill combinations, because those are not always readily available and affordable. Again, the opportunity by choosing wisely, we can limit our patients' out-of-pocket costs and wait times for blood pressure medications. Again, long waits in the pharmacy for medications may not be readily available can be a discouragement to our patient. And as I'll suggest, it enables us to obtain prompt and sustained blood pressure control more efficiently than if we don't have a treatment algorithm. And also by having a treatment algorithm, it begins to mimic clinical trials, where patients going from usual care to clinical trial typically have a significant improvement in the control rate. Well, we can have a treatment algorithm in our usual practice that can help us replicate the good control that's typically seen in clinical trials. Next slide, please. Well, what are the components of a hypertension treatment algorithm that you may want to consider for your clinic or practice? Well, the obvious is having a plan where to initiate, what medication or medications am I going to start with, and what's the sequence I'm going to use to add medications, and having that known ahead of time and very thoughtfully considered, particularly agreed upon by a team of clinicians and care providers, can be an effective tool. The follow-up frequency, in general, the recommendation is not necessarily for weekly follow-up, although if we could do that, it might have some advantages, but at least trying to get monthly follow-up unless the blood pressure is severely elevated, in which case we'd probably want to reduce that return visit interval. So while the blood pressure is uncontrolled, whether intensifying or initiating therapy, aim for those one-month follow-ups. It could be an electronic visit, a telephone call, other means. It wouldn't necessarily have to be an in-person office visit. And if it is an in-person office visit, it wouldn't necessarily have to be with the physician. It could be with other care team members who are familiar with the algorithm we have selected. Also, by having an algorithm with certain medications, you may decide that you want to have certain labs before beginning a medication, or after you add or intensify a medication. Again, having a standardized algorithm helps to ensure that most of our patients benefit from that good care that we've decided on beforehand. I've just shared some examples there. For example, if you are beginning an aldosterone antagonist, it's useful to know the electrolytes and the estimated glomerular filtration rate ahead of time, because if the EGFR is low and the potassium is high, then that patient's risk, for example, for hyperkalemia could be very substantial. Next slide, please. So this is just a suggested treatment algorithm. There are many potentially out there. Strongly recommended, when possible, beginning with a single pill combination. What I've shown here are standard doses. These are half maximal doses. The reason for mentioning this is we typically obtain 80% of the blood pressure lowering effect of our medications at standard or half maximal doses. That's not necessarily that we have to begin there, but again, it's a reasonable starting point for many medications, although particularly if there are concerns with single pill combinations, starting with that low dose, such as 2.5/10, would be a reasonable starting point. Now, if you begin with an initial calcium channel blocker, the recommendation would be add a RAS blocker, such as lisinopril, which is an ACE inhibitor, or an angiotensin receptor blocker. And then adding to that a thiazide-like diuretic, such as hydrochlorothiazide, indapamide, or chlorothalidone. Hydrochlorothiazide is often underdosed. The standard dose is 25, the maximum recommended dose 50. If you begin with a calcium channel blocker and RAS blocker and add that thiazide-like diuretic and the blood pressure is still uncontrolled, the patient is doing their best on lifestyle, you've verified adherence, the EGFR is 60 or higher, the serum potassium less than 4.5, then spironolactone is probably our single most effective fourth medication for treating that patient that's resistant to those three usually effective medications. Next slide, please. So I wanted to share with you some of the known benefits of single pill combinations for the treatment of hypertension. Again, the majority of our patients require combination therapy, although fortunately, a minority are controlled on monotherapy. But again, for patients that require more than one medication, which is the rule rather than the exception, single pill combinations lead to better adherence than when the pills are prescribed separately. Typically, our therapeutic inertia is less when we start with lower dose single pill combinations and titrate up than trying to add a second medication. I'll show some evidence for that as well. Several studies have shown that we get to blood pressure control more rapidly within that 6 month period or less, and better sustained control when we start with single pill combinations. And there's also data suggesting that our patients have fewer cardiovascular events and live longer when we use single pill combinations. Some of the references are shown. Next slide, please. One of the concerns that's often raised when thinking about beginning initial single pill combination is excessive reductions in blood pressure and a greater likelihood of adverse reactions or serious adverse effects. Well, in fact, a careful meta-analysis and systematic review suggested that compared with standard dose monotherapy, initiating treatment with low to standard doses of combination therapy was not only more effective for controlling blood pressure, but did not lead to increased withdrawals due to adverse effects. Next slide, please. In a Canadian study done by a colleague of many of ours, Dr. Ross Feldman, and published a few years ago, as you see in Hypertension, worked with primary care practices across Canada, and the practices were randomized for patients that were untreated and uncontrolled to begin either with monotherapy, titrate that up, and then add medications, or to begin with a low-dose single-pill combination. What they showed is after 6 months, about 65% of the patients randomized initially to low-dose single-pill combination achieved blood pressure control, compared to about 53% of those randomized to begin with monotherapy. Not shown on the slide is that the physicians in practice is actually randomized to single-pill combinations actually preferred that and were more likely to recommend it to others. Next slide, please. In this study, which also comes from Canada, where they looked at the patients 66 years and older, 13,000 of them, and looked at the same medication prescribed separately or together, that is an ACE inhibitor and thiazide diuretic, either as a single pill combination or separate pills, and follow up over 5 years, showed that the patients were more likely to possess the medication, proportion of days covered, was higher with the fixed dose combination than with separate pills. And also that the primary outcome of death or hospitalization for heart attack, heart failure, or stroke was also significantly reduced. So again, amongst these older adults, initiating a combination RAS blocker diuretic therapy as compared to the pills prescribed separately was associated with the patients more likely to possess and likely take the medication and more likely to have favorable clinical outcomes. Next slide, please. This is a study that comes to us from Italy based on a national database that includes medication data. And they had 125,000 patients, as you see, 100,000 of whom were begun on a single drug versus about 25,000 that were started on two medications, often as a single pill combination, but not necessarily. Notice that over 3 years, the patients begun on single pill combination were less likely to be on combination therapy even after 3 years. Only about a third of patients started on a single medication were on combination. Most of them remained on a single pill monotherapy. In contrast, those that were started on two medications were about 80% of them remained on combination therapy at 1, 2, and 3 years. The table shows us on the right-hand side that cardiovascular events were 16% fewer in those started on combination therapy. Heart failure reduced about 35%, stroke reduced 15%, ischemic heart disease reduced 20%, and death rates 20% lower for those begun on combination therapy than on a monotherapy. So again, adherence appears to be better and clinical outcomes are better when we start patients on combination therapy. Next slide, please. Well, I shared with you at the outset that there's data suggesting that our patients do better when we control blood pressure early in the course of treatment and sustain control over time rather than having variable control. And this is a multi-study review by a group of authors, European authors, published about 5 years ago, in fact, showing that the target blood pressure less than 140 over less than 90 appeared sufficient for most patients if we have early control and sustain that control rather than varying back and forth. As I'll show you, patients that are consistently controlled to less than 140 typically have a blood pressure of 130 or less. So if we're happy with blood pressures of 135 to 139, we do not achieve consistent control. It looks like our patients don't do as well. If we consistently control the blood pressure to less than 140, we most likely will have achieved a blood pressure of 130 or less. Next slide, please. Well, I wanted to show that if you're familiar with what's called a normal distribution, where if we look at the mean and a standard deviation, and typically about two-thirds of the distribution is within plus or minus one standard deviation of the mean. If in this case, we assume we're trying to control blood pressure to less than 140, and we place that at one standard deviation above the mean, 84% of the distribution will lie to the left of the mean. In this case, with a standard deviation of 12, typically the blood pressure distribution in an individual is at least a 10 millimeter, an individual patient, and for a group of patients, typically 12 millimeters or more. But if we assume 12, which is within the ballpark of what you see in clinical practice, that would put the mean at 128. Even with a goal of less than 140, if we achieve high rates of control, we're likely to achieve a mean systolic blood pressure of 128 or less. Notice, though, that we still have a group of patients that are uncontrolled. And typically in blood pressure, the distribution is skewed a bit to the upper end or the right. That is, there will be a group of patients that will continue to have blood pressures in the 150s and 160s. But if we achieve that mean pressure of around 127, 128, likely we'll control 80% or more of our patients to less than 140. If our goal is to control them consistently to less than 130, then we probably need to get the mean blood pressure to 120 or less. Next slide. So that's theoretical and may have caused your eyes to cross. I wanted to pull out some actual data and share that with you. So here we have some data that we can look at together to see if what I've suggested based on a normal distribution applies to clinical trials and to the US population. Notice in 1998 to 2002, the average blood pressure of treated patients in the US was around 136, 137. And 60% of treated patients had a systolic blood pressure of less than 140. Notice that in 2003 to 2008, the average systolic blood pressure among treated patients in the US had fallen to 132. And now around 68 to 69% were controlled to less than 140 based on the NHANES data. By 2009 to 2012, the average systolic blood pressure of treated patients in the U.S. had fallen to 130, and now 72% had a blood pressure of less than 140 systolic. In the first year of SPRINT, the average systolic blood pressure was around 136, similar to the U.S. population in 1999 to 2002, and about 60% had a blood pressure less than 140 over 90. In the SPRINT intensive treated group, the average systolic blood pressure was around 121 to 122, and 88 to 90% had a systolic blood pressure less than 140. So again, the theoretical blood pressure based on the distribution I showed on the previous slide is basically borne out in the US population in clinical trials. That is, if we want to have high control rates, we need to control the average systolic blood pressure to 130 or less. Next slide, please. I wanted to go back to where we were at the beginning and talking about the modeling and the advantages of having a treatment algorithm. Notice some of the challenges that we run into here. The return visit interval. So if our algorithm includes that we want to have that monthly follow-up, that can have a significant impact on blood pressure control. If we aim to intensify blood pressure medications when blood pressure is not controlled, particularly adding a medication at standard dose, if we add a medication at standard dose, we get about 80% of a blood pressure lowering effect and often 8 to 10 millimeter reduction in blood pressure. Doubling the dose of medication from standard to maximum dose typically gives us a 2 to 3 millimeter reduction in blood pressure. So we get about three times the effect of adding a medication at standard dose than we do from doubling an existing medication from standard to maximum dose. However, if we had a patient on a single pill combination and doubled the doses of two medications, then we get more like a 5 to 6 millimeter average reduction in blood pressure. Next slide, please. So let's go back to the case we started with at the beginning. This was an individual, as we saw, who had a blood pressure in the roughly 146, 147 range. He's followed up at 1 month. He elected, as they did in the Canadian study, to start with low-dose single-pill combination, although you could have, in this case, started probably very safely with a standard dose. But in this case, following the study that was done in Canada and the good results they had, you started a low-dose single-pill combination. Notice that his blood pressure has fallen about 10 to 12 millimeters of mercury, both based on the self-measured blood pressure and the automated office blood pressure. He's lost 2 pounds during that 1 month interval. Remember, we said, though, if you're happy with blood pressures in 135 to 140 range, you're not going to have consistent control or high levels of control. So judging by this, the blood pressure therapy, while it's been successful, has not been adequate to get that blood pressure to 130 or less. So you have some options here that you could try. One, you could continue the current therapy and hope that the lifestyle changes lower it further. You're probably not going to get significant additional incremental effect after a month on this medication. You could add a medication, indapamide, and likely to get an 8 to 10 millimeter further reduction in blood pressure. You could increase the amlodipine only and get maybe 3-4 millimeter reduction in blood pressure. Or you could double both the amlodipine benazepril in that single pill combination and get around that 5 to 6 millimeter reduction in blood pressure. And again, there's no necessarily right or wrong answer. I would suggest intensifying therapy either by doubling the dose of both medications or adding indapamide would get us the results we're looking for. Whenever, though, we can potentially control blood pressure without adding another medication, our patients prefer that. And we, again, would like to follow this patient up within a month to see what's happening. If the medication is well tolerated, you could double the amlodipine benazepril again to 1040 and very, very likely control his blood pressure to less than 130 without excessive hypotension, probably getting in the 126 to 128 range where he's likely to have consistent control. Next slide, please. So let me review with you the learning objectives that we set out here at the beginning. What I've tried to share with you is the advantages of having a standardized algorithm. For many years, what we've often said as clinicians is we want to tailor the therapy for each patient. And whenever patients go from our care into a clinical trial where the algorithm is standardized, they typically do better. So while we would like to do it, the complexity of our patients, the limited time, the difficulty in coordinating our communication with a team by tailoring therapy for everybody, and basically ending up with a lot of different regimens, tends to not be an efficient way to get good care and good blood pressure control. I've tried to share with you the advantages of single pill combinations and the safety of beginning low and standard doses of single pill combination therapy, and using good clinical judgment, if you have a frail patient and you're concerned about hypotension, either low-dose single or a single medication is the way to go. Monthly follow-ups, titration, escalation of medication, and also reinforcing the point that adding a medication at standard or half maximal dose has about three times the blood pressure lowering effect of doubling the dose of a current medication. And then again, if we want to get high and consistent control to less than 140, we probably need to achieve a blood pressure no higher than and preferably less than 130. If we want to get control consistently less than 130, we probably need to be no higher than 120 or slightly below. I'd like to stop at this point. Happy to entertain any questions, time permitting, and turn it back over to our session chair.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Egan. You know, you've just been very generous with your time this morning. I want to thank you for joining us today and, of course, for your leadership of the American Medical Association. And now I want to welcome Dr. Narula. She's Assistant Professor of Medicine, Division of Cardiology at Weill Cornell Medical College. Welcome, Dr. Narula.
Thank you so much. So good morning, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Phillips, Robin, the American Heart Association, and meeting organizers for giving me the opportunity to present today on the role of choosing a blood pressure device for home monitoring. I have no disclosures. Next slide, please. So the 2017 American College of Cardiology and American Heart Association guidelines updated the definition of hypertension to lower threshold values, resulting in an increased prevalence of hypertension diagnosis in the United States. Now, this is data from the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey, which from 2017 to 2018 demonstrated a hypertension prevalence of greater than 45% in all comers greater than age 18 years, highlighting the importance, as the AHA emphasizes, of knowing our numbers. Next slide, please. Now, measurement of office blood pressures was relied on for several years for making a diagnosis of hypertension. However, as you can imagine, there are certain limitations. So here, on the horizontal or x-axis, we see rising office blood pressures. And on the vertical or y-axis, we have rising home blood pressures. Next slide, please. You can go back one. Yep, thank you. So a normal blood pressure at home and an elevated blood pressure at the doctor's office, as designated by the red boxes, can indicate a white coat phenomenon. So if an individual is not on antihypertensive medications, this is referred to as white coat hypertension. And if an individual is on antihypertensive medications, this is referred to as a white coat effect. Next slide, please. Now, white coat hypertension may potentially be associated with some increase in cardiovascular events and mortality. Next slide, please. Now, alternatively, blood pressure can be within normal range in the doctor's office, and it can be elevated at home, as indicated by the red boxes. Next slide, please. And this represents a phenomenon of masked hypertension if a patient is not on antihypertensive medications, and masked uncontrolled hypertension if a patient is on antihypertensive medications. Next slide, please. And we know that both of these entities, namely masked hypertension and masked uncontrolled hypertension, have a significant association with increased cardiovascular risk. Next slide, please. And this really highlights the role of out-of-office blood pressure monitoring, which should really be complementary to office blood pressure monitoring. Now, out-of-office blood pressure monitoring is present in two forms: ambulatory blood pressure monitoring and home blood pressure monitoring, the latter of which is the measurement of blood pressure by an individual outside of an office setting. So for example, in his or her home. And these two methods, for several reasons, including timing, tolerability, availability, are not entirely interchangeable. And we will focus here on choosing a device for home blood pressure monitoring. Next slide, please. So an accurate home blood pressure monitoring device can be effective for the diagnosis of hypertension and for serial monitoring of blood pressures. Next slide, please. And based on this algorithm from the 2017 Hypertension Clinical Practice Guidelines, home blood pressure monitoring can be used to monitor and titrate antihypertensive therapies. Next slide, please. So let's talk about blood pressure devices on the market and how we choose one for monitoring, since we know that there are many out there. You know, I'd like to allude back to what Dr. Shimbo had referred to in one of the opening talks. So the Food and Drug Administration, or the FDA 510K program for marketing medical devices is based upon a finding of, quote, substantial equivalence to an available predicate. So to fulfill this, it must be shown that the device has, one, the same intended use as the predicate, two, the same technological characteristics as the predicate, or if different technological characteristics, that it does not raise different questions of safety and effectiveness. And lastly, that the device is as safe and effective as the legally marketed device. Next slide, please. An important adjunct and addition to this, however, that is not implicit in the FDA program is really that of validation, or the testing process that demonstrates that the device you created actually functions as it's intended to for the consumer. So the American Medical Association, the AHA, and the National Opinion Research Center at the University of Chicago convened with experts and other expert organizations to develop the Validated Blood Pressure Device Listing, or the VDL, which is really the first United States list of blood pressure measurement devices established to assist both providers and patients in identifying devices that have been validated for clinical accuracy. Next slide. Now, this VDL criteria is really composed of three components. So firstly, the importance of cuff size testing and availability. Notably, a small cuff can overestimate your blood pressure, and a large cuff can underestimate your blood pressure. Next slide, please. Now, the second component of the VDL criteria includes the documentation of independent validation testing using a known protocol. Next slide, please. And the third and final component of the VDL criteria is to ensure that every model variant claimed has no deviation from the clinically validated model that would impact blood pressure values or accuracy. So where do we find all of this important information? Next slide, please. So validatebp.org is one site where this information is readily available. So it's a site where you have information about the device, the different models, the sizes, the validation protocols that are used, and it's really accessible in a very centralized fashion. And therefore, physicians, healthcare providers, pharmacists, patients can go to a website and know that the device that's listed there has been validated for clinical accuracy. Next slide, please. There are other websites, for example, that include validation information on self-measured blood pressure monitoring devices. So this includes Stride BP, which is affiliated with the European Society of Hypertension, the International Society of Hypertension, and the World Hypertension League. In addition, other websites that include information regarding validation information are Hypertension Canada and the British and Irish Hypertension Society. Next slide, please. Now, when you're choosing a device, a blood pressure monitoring device for monitoring, there are other features that should also be taken into consideration. So firstly, the type of device. Upper arm cuffs are strongly preferred if this is feasible. The ease of obtaining a blood pressure reading with the click of a button, that can be considered for some individuals. A good clean display should be considered. Next slide, please. The ability to program repeat blood pressure checks in a specific time interval is a feature of certain devices and helps to facilitate more of a monitored schedule. the ability to record time of blood pressure check, including for multiple family members, and send them to a healthcare team is a feature of devices that should be discussed with patients. And lastly, the ability to detect arrhythmias with reasonable accuracy is another aspect of certain devices if this is applicable. Next slide, please. So with all of this said, understanding the context of the patient population is integral. So I'll give you two examples. In terms of pregnancy, there was a recent robust systematic analysis, a systematic review, with Dr. Bello and Dr. Shimbo, which demonstrates that certain blood pressure monitoring devices have not passed validation protocols sufficiently. And similarly, we can see that in children, further investigation of the validation criteria is necessary. Next slide, please. And as a result, in this patient population, and in fact for all devices overall, an important step is calibrating your home monitoring device to the auscultatory method in your doctor's office. Next slide, please. So with that, I'd like to thank you very much for your attention and for the opportunity to speak today.
Well, thank you, Dr. Narula, for your presentation today and for your continued support of the American Heart Association here in New York City. Now, let's welcome nurse practitioner Marion, adult nurse practitioner at the Hypertension Center, Weill Cornell Medical College, Division of Nephrology and Hypertension. Welcome.
Thank you very much. First slide, please. In this segment, I will focus on various reasons for using the 24-hour blood pressure monitors in your medical practice, and I have no disclosures. I will include the benefits of use, back please, the benefits of use, the types of machines, how they work, the cost, the reimbursement issues, and comparing blood pressure monitors. Next slide, please. It would be remiss if I did not mention Dr. Thomas Pickering, who was an internationally renowned physician, clinical scientist, professor, and expert in clinical hypertension. Now, Dr. Pickering coined the term white coat hypertension to describe those whose blood pressure was elevated in the doctor's office, but normal in everyday life. And also published the first editorial describing masked hypertension, which is the opposite of white coat hypertension. Now, most importantly, Dr. Pickering was an advocate of out-of-office blood pressure measurement and introduced the 24-hour blood pressure monitoring at the Hypertension Center in the late 1970s. Now, those first devices consisted of two units. A bit cumbersome. One was just to take the blood pressure, and the other was a Holter monitor for, of course, the heart rate and EKG. Weighed approximately 10 pounds, a bit cumbersome, and we were all asked to wear them as well. Now the monitor does everything from taking the blood pressure to the heart rate to the pulse pressure, and gives you the mean arterial pressure and morning surge index, weighs 4 pounds, and is the size of a Walkman. Next slide, please. There are many benefits to the 24-hour blood pressure monitors, and the more you use them, you see the benefits of them. They definitely assist with therapeutic decisions. It determines the effectiveness of blood pressure medications. It also assists in the evaluation of drug resistance. And as we've been discussing in earlier sections, it improves adherence to therapy. It allows the patient to assist with their own response to medication. You can show them this and they'll see how their blood pressure medications are working, or truly what time they should be taking their medications as well. That leads to number two, nocturnal changes, dippers versus non-dippers. So we see that the absence of lowering blood pressure while a patient is asleep has shown to be a risk factor for heart failure and stroke. And I'm going to be showing you an example of a dipper in just a minute. Number three, the difference between clinic and home readings. Measurements in the office settings are unrepresentative of the patient's true blood pressure over a 24-hour cycle. You don't get to see the patterns of the blood pressure, which are very important. And number four, diagnosing white coat hypertension and masked hypertension. Now, estimates are that 1 in 4 patients diagnosed with hypertension actually have high readings only in the doctor's office. And this, of course, is with their blood pressure without target organ damage. So you still have to do your homework and checking the patients out for secondary risk factors. Now, masked hypertension has been called reversed white coat hypertension. The patient appears normotensive in the office, but has elevated ambulatory blood pressure readings. Now, it has been shown that patients with masked hypertension have extensive target organ damage, and it's estimated to be about 5% of the adult population. All right, next slide, please. How they work. They're fully automatic with a pump to inflate and deflate the blood pressure cuff at set intervals. The standard is every 20 minutes while awake and every hour when sleeping. You can set these monitors for what you feel is good for your patients. We feel this is the best. They're battery powered. They record 50 to 100 readings. All of these readings are stored in memory of a recorder, then uploaded into a computer or ambulatory blood pressure analysis system. Now, each monitor is carried in a pouch that is strapped or belted to the side of the patient. And we do instruct the patient to wear loose clothing. And the cuff will inflate. These blood pressure monitors have been designed to be used on patients with normal sinus rhythm. Arrhythmias will affect the performance. All right, next slide, please. Types of ambulatory blood pressure monitors are many. You can get new models and refurbished models. You could even go on eBay and buy these models now, which I wouldn't recommend, because when you do purchase these models, at least you get help from the company, especially in the very beginning when you're getting used to using them. Now, the optimal ambulatory blood pressure monitor device for population-based surveys is unknown. But I found that there was a wonderful study that showed a comparison of 3 devices for 24-hour ambulatory blood pressures in a non-clinical environment through a randomized trial. And this was done, shown in the American Journal of Hypertension in November of 2020. So what it did was it compared 365 adults and 120 participants wore each one of these monitors. So as you see, the first monitor on the left-hand side is the Welsh Allyn Mobile Ograph monitor. And here in the bottom, it has the monitor itself. You see the pouch and you see the cuffs and they see the software. Then there's the SunTech Classic Oscar II. Now this cuff was a little firmer. And then you have the Space Labs 90227. This is known as the legacy monitor. It's been used both in research and clinically. And this is the monitor that we're most familiar with and we've been using in our center for pretty much the last 30 years. Now, these 3 osculometric devices were selected and had been previously validated. And this is important. You want to make sure that whatever equipment you choose, it has been validated by the American Association of Medical Instrumentation and cleared by the FDA for ambulatory blood pressure measurement. So next slide, please. The study assessed various outcomes, but I wanted to show you one that I thought was important in choosing the equipment. You have to realize your patient just can't come back with six readings for 24 hours. You want a good validation. And an acceptable ambulatory blood pressure test was defined as having at least 70% of valid blood pressure readings. So here, each one of these monitors, on the right-hand side, you see the percentage of participants with greater than or equal to 70% of the valid systolic and diastolic readings while awake. The Wechsler-Allen was 75.6, Suntech 81, and Space Labs 81.5. So they're all pretty good. And on the left, I thought this was important that you see the sleep readings. The percentage of participants of greater than or equal to 70% valid blood pressure readings while asleep. Most patients really don't like the idea that they have to wear the monitor while sleeping. I have to admit that the first reading, some people get startled, but after that, blood pressure lowers and they do not even feel the blood pressure being taken during the night. Next slide, please. All right, very busy, but this is the example of an ambulatory blood pressure report from the Space Labs monitor. It gives you a great summary, and this is only the first page of 8 pages that you will be getting. So in the first red box, it shows the overall summary. The next box is the wake period summary, and the next one are the sleep period summary. It also gives you the hourly average, the lowest blood pressure readings, and the highest with the times. And it gives you a percentage of the dipping. I want you to go down to the bottom graph, and you see this is a great example of a beat-to-beat blood pressure as far as the patient's dipping. I'm sorry, there was a blockage on my screen here. So at patient went to sleep at 8:30, and you see his blood pressure starting to go down at 9 p.m. And at 2:30 in the morning, he's really dipping nicely, and then he goes back up. So that's an example of a dipper. You will also have to interpret these readings, and you see that this patient's blood pressure was acceptable. It shows that he's a marked dipper and he has high variability. For time's sake, I'm not going to go over all of this, but this is a good summary. And as I said, you will also get each individual reading, blood pressure reading for this patient, and that helps you assess everything. All right, let's go to the next slide. Oh, now to the nitty gritty, the costs. The models range from $3,000 to $9,000, the refurbished $1,000. You need 2 cuffs of each size. It does come with a child's cuff. They do not recommend that you use this on a child younger than 5. You have to worry about the cords around the patient's neck. It comes in regular adult and large size cuff. Of course, you have to have cables, ambulatory blood pressure report generator, and a printer, unless you have your own, and then you just need the software. Accessories, everything is extra. The pouch, the shoulder strap, and you have to have a T-tube calibration accessory. This is necessary to determine the accuracy of these blood pressure monitors before you send the patients out on their way. So what you have to do is you have to test this monitor against a standard mercury sphygmomanometer by manual activation. We just test it and we use 3 successive readings using this Y connector. And in order to ensure that there are no consistent differences. So you also need to have cuff covers and a patient diary form. The diaries are necessary because you want to know when that patient ate, when they went to sleep, when they woke up, when they had an argument, etc. And all of this has to be put in by hand by your technician. So the most important thing that you need to have is a good trained technician. They need to give instructions to this patient. They need to put the monitor on correctly and then follow through the next day during the download. All right, the next slide, please. Reimbursement. Sorry about this, but you must know Medicare finally, after writing for a long period of time, Medicare allows coverage for the monitors, but there are rules and regulations. So they will approve if you have suspected white coat hypertension, and also if you have suspected mast hypertension. And you can go to all the rules for Medicare in order to see what they will approve. And your biller or you have to look at this, because you do want to get something back. Medicare covers, we receive $56 from Medicare. And then secondary, of course, from other insurances. Most insurances now do cover for ambulatory blood pressure monitorings. And I say currently, because they always change. We also have every patient, receives a waiver. They must sign it to know the limitations of the coverage. Next slide, please. In summary, the 24-hour blood pressure monitors are reliable, really. If they're put on properly, the patient is given instructions, they will do fine. They're reasonably convenient to wear. We've had patients of every walk of life, from teachers to pilots to astronauts, wear this equipment. And they greatly assist in therapeutic decisions. And we feel they're vital to the diagnosis and care of the hypertension patients. Last slide, please. And I want to truly thank Dr. Phyllis August, who's director of the Hypertension Center, and Dr. Subhantharan, who's chief division of nephrology and hypertension, who are always encouraging and supporting us through our work here at the Hypertension Center, and all of the practitioners, Dr. Mark Pecker, Sam Mann, Dr. Lynn Mala, our wonderful administrator, and Jennifer Grimes, who is a technician for the 24-hour blood pressure monitor, and our great staff, Rochelle Katz and Ange Lasco. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Well, thank you, Nurse Practitioner Marion. That was a phenomenal presentation. And now I want to welcome Dr. Diamond. He's with the American Society of Hypertension, clinical specialist in hypertension, Long Island Jewish Medical Center. Welcome, Dr. Diamond.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you, Diego Ortiz Quintero, and I want to thank Larry Phillips for the invitation. And it's a pleasure to be here with all my esteemed colleagues. Today, I'm going to briefly talk to you about an approach to secondary hypertension. And it's a lot to cover, but I'm going to try to keep it nice and simple. If we can go to the first slide. So the 2017 guidelines for hypertension from the American Heart Association and the American College of Cardiology addressed screening for secondary hypertension. This is a summary to guide us on how to approach it, so that if we have new onset hypertension, uncontrolled hypertension in adults, we look for certain pre-specified conditions from our initial evaluation. Is there drug-resistant or drug-induced hypertension? Was there an abrupt onset of hypertension? Is this a new onset of hypertension? Is there an exacerbation of previously controlled hypertension? Is there a disproportionate amount of target organ damage for the degree of hypertension? Is there an accelerated or malignant type of hypertension? Is there onset of diastolic hypertension in older adults, where we might typically see more of a systolic hypertension? Or is there unprovoked or unexplained excessive hypokalemia? And in these scenarios, we might decide it's time to screen for secondary hypertension. And this is a class one indication. If we don't see these findings, then we would not necessarily need to screen for secondary hypertension. If there's a positive screening test, it's generally recommended at this point to refer the patient to a clinician who has specific expertise in the workup and evaluation of secondary hypertension. And this might be an American Heart Association clinical specialist in hypertension, or somebody in one of the areas of specialty for treating and diagnosing hypertension. If we go to the next slide. So here are the most common causes of secondary hypertension. As you can see on the top of the list is obstructive sleep apnea, which will be addressed by my colleague, Dr. Forsheimer, shortly. I'll touch a little bit on it in this talk. We have primary hyperaldosteronism with about a 7 to 20% prevalence, followed by renal artery stenosis, renal parenchymal disease, drug-induced or alcohol-induced hypertension, something we should always include in our initial history, thyroid disease. And you can see at the bottom of the list is pheochromocytoma. I think this is interesting because, you know, many of us who initially think of doing a workup of secondary causes of hypertension will initially start with the getting 24-hour urine metanephrines and workup for pheo, when this might be the least likely cause of a resistant severe hypertension. And we might not think to do an initial history screening for obstructive sleep apnea. So I think this is kind of eye-opening. If we go to the next slide. This is from the 2017 guidelines, a little summary of how to approach secondary causes of hypertension. We'll start with renovascular hypertension with a prevalence of about 5 to 34%. We will think about renovascular hypertension in the scenario of resistant high blood pressure, hypertension of an abrupt onset, or if somebody has a history of chronic hypertension where their sudden worsening becomes difficult to control, requiring multiple changes of the blood pressure regimen. Often in older individuals, this might present as suddenly severe hypertension associated with flash pulmonary edema. This might be a presentation of atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis. Or in younger people, particularly women more than men, an early onset hypertension at a young age might be a sign of fibromuscular hyperplasia. The physical exam for renovascular hypertension in generally involves using the stethoscope over the abdomen to listen for abdominal bruits, or as a clue of general atherosclerotic disease, you might notice bruits in other areas. If you're listening for these bruits, I would remind you that in the abdomen, the kidney and the renal arteries are not very superficial. So you might have to use your diaphragm and press a little bit hard. And in a quiet environment, listen carefully and you might hear those bruits. The screening tests for renal artery stenosis would be a renal duplex Doppler. It's usually very good. Sometimes bowel gas can interfere with the acquisition of good pictures. So we'll often ask our patients to come in with a period of fasting in order to get good quality studies. And an MRA or abdominal CT may be used. And then additional confirmatory tests might be renal angiography. Renal parenchymal disease may also be a cause in about prevalence 1 to 2%. This might present in patients with frequent urinary tract infections, obstruction, hematuria, urinary frequency, analgesic use, the non-steroidals, family history of polycystic kidney disease, patients presenting with elevated serum creatinines, abnormalities on the urinalysis. Physical exam is somewhat limited. You're probably going to make this diagnosis based on labs. However, in patients with polycystic kidney disease, you might see, you might be able to palpate some masses in the kidney area. And again, the tests to evaluate renal function will be where you go here. Next slide. So again, just in summary for renovascular disease, the majority of patients are going to be older with atherosclerotic renal artery disease. In younger patients, women more than men, it might be fibromuscular dysplasia. Renal artery stenosis, that's atherosclerotic, might more likely involve the proximal portion of the renal artery. The mid to distal portion with that beading appearance may be more what you'll see with fibromuscular dysplasia. Next slide. So this is a clinical example from my patients. This is a magnetic resonance angiogram of the abdomen shown in panel A. The white arrow is outlining the right renal artery, and you can see the typical appearance of beading, aneurysmal dilatation in the mid to distal half of that right renal artery. In panel B, there's a selective renal angiogram of the same patient. And again, the three arrows are showing that beading pattern that you would see in fibromuscular dysplasia. And then the panel C on the bottom shows the same artery, same area after an intervention is done with angioplasty, showing a nice improvement in the appearance of that renal artery. Next slide. Here are some more typical patterns of renal artery stenosis. Panel A showing that fibromuscular dysplasia beading pattern. Some other patterns are shown here, both pre and post treatment. Panel C showing a typical atherosclerotic renal artery. Next slide. So in terms of the approach to renal artery stenosis, there have been some excellent clinical trials, the ASTRAL trial, followed by the CORAL trial, really adjusted our approach to renal artery stenosis. Next slide, please. In this graph, we're seeing that that there was no difference in the composite endpoint for CORAL in terms of death, myocardial infarction, stroke, hospitalization for progression of renal disease or progression to dialysis, that there was 35.1% progression in the group that received medical therapy plus a stent, 35.8% in the medical therapy alone group with a hazard ratio of 0.94. Again, no statistical difference, suggesting that most patients with renal or artery stenosis can be treated medically. However, there have been some subgroup analysis done of both the ASTRAL and the CORAL trial. Some came out of Europe from the European Journal of Vascular and Endovascular Medicine. And if we go to the next slide, you'll see that this sub-analysis of these trials showed that there might be some select group of patients that do benefit from an intervention. Those patients with renal artery stenosis greater than 80% with a significant translesional pressure gradient. Those patients who are demonstrating very difficult to control blood pressure medicine despite good antihypertensive therapy, especially in younger patients. Patients with significant truncal stenoses rather than ostial stenoses. Patients who are showing a rapid deterioration of renal function, such as a rising serum creatinine. Patients presenting with flash pulmonary edema, and select post-transplant renal artery stenosis patients may still benefit from undergoing a stent placement, PCI, along with medical therapy. Next slide. So for the guidelines, recommendations for renal artery stenosis are outlined here. Class 1 medical therapy is recommended for adults with atherosclerotic renal artery stenosis. However, in adults with renal artery stenosis who fail medical therapy, who have refractory hypertension, who have worsening renal function, or who develop heart failure, flash pulmonary edema, those select patients, including also the patients with fibromuscular dysplasia, may benefit from undergoing revascularization. So if we go to the next slide. Primary hyperaldosteronism has a prevalence of 8 to 20%. Resistant hypertension, hypertension in the setting of unexplained hypokalemia, a sudden significant drop of potassium on a typical dose of diuretic might be clues. Patients may present with arrhythmias that are due to the hypokalemia. Tests may be the plasma aldosterone to renin ratio. There may be other tests that we do that are outlined on the left, such as oral loading with saline, testing for aldosterone levels. If we go to the next slide. So the initial screening might be to stop mineralocorticoid agents such as spironolactone, obtain direct plasma renin or plasma renin activity, look for aldosterone levels, and derive an aldosterone renin ratio. I can tell you in my clinical practice, I might get these tests before stopping the agents because it's time consuming to wait. And then, you know, on their drugs, if they have a very significantly high aldosterone to renin ratio, that might confirm your diagnosis. If you're not sure, you might do confirmatory saline suppression testing, in which case giving a saline load will suppress the renin aldosterone system, and therefore you can see if there's evidence of effect on your AAR or your aldosterone levels. Next slide. So recommendations for primary hyperaldosteronism in adults with hypertension, screening is recommended in the presence of resistant hypertension with hypokalemia, spontaneous, or if induced by use of diuretic, especially in young people. People who have target organ damage out of proportion to the extent of hypertension. We use the aldosterone renin activity ratio. Again, a ratio of greater than 20 has an 85% sensitivity. A ratio of about 23.6 increases that sensitivity to about 97% with a specificity of about 94%. If we go to the next slide, this is an MRI of the adrenal gland. On the left-hand side, you see the arrow pointing to the left adrenal gland. This is an enlarged or hypertrophied adrenal gland. We do not see the right adrenal gland very easily. This was a patient who actually initially presented with hypertension during pregnancy that resolved. And then many years later, she presented with severe hypertension that was not well controlled, a serum potassium of about 3.5 to 4. And again, there was tumor, the selective injection of the adrenal gland is shown on the right. You can see the vessels. There is no outline of tumor blush, suggesting that this might be some kind of primary hyperaldosteronism. And further testing confirmed that selective adrenal sampling of aldosterone, 18-OH hydroxycortisone, and cortisol levels were done. Tests for autonomous production were done, and this confirmed the presence of primary hyperaldosteronism. Go to the next slide. We mustn't ignore sleep apnea. It's fairly common. History of snoring, fitful breathing, witnessed apnea. A physical exam might include looking at a Mallampati score where you look at the throat. If you can see the full throat, that's considered class one. If you can see the full uvula, that would be class two. If you see partial uvula, that might be class three, et cetera. There are questionnaires such as the Epworth sleeplessness score, the Berlin questionnaire that are used, and the definitive test is polysomnography. Next slide. Pearls on obstructive sleep apnea, repetitive interruptions of ventilation lasting more than 10 seconds during sleep. Normally, as you heard in the previous talk, there should be a nocturnal dip. Sometimes patients with sleep apnea have what we call reverse dipping, where the sleep blood pressures are actually higher than the daytime sleeping. The definitive diagnosis will be with polysomnography. Clinical trials have demonstrated a modest reduction of blood pressure using CPAP. There is a potential role for spironolactone, not only as a treatment for hypertension and sleep apnea, but actually to help with sleep apnea itself. If we go to the next slide. This is ambulatory blood pressure monitoring. Each vertical line shows a measured blood pressure. The area in gray below defines the period of sleep. And here we are seeing sleep blood pressures that are actually higher than the wake blood pressures, showing a reverse dip in a patient with obstructive sleep apnea. If we look at the next slide, we're going to see an example of polysomnography on the top, showing the summary of blood pressure of recordings made between midnight and 5 a.m. And we have here a period on the left with boxes B and C, which shows that there is a sudden discontinuation of breathing, disconcordance between abdominal excursion, thoracic excursion. The top area shows the EEG. Suddenly there's an arousal period where box A is. then there's sudden resumption of normal breathing and concordance between abdominal and thoracic breathing patterns. This is an example of a sleep apnea. This patient had about 68 of these over the course of the night. If we go to the next slide, recommendations for obstructive sleep apnea are here. I'll try to go quickly for the purposes of time. Again, spironolactone may reduce the severity of obstructive sleep apnea and help with the resistant hypertension that we see associated with it. If we go to the next slide, drug or alcohol-induced hypertension has a 2-4% prevalence. It's very important to check for this. If we go to the next slide, we see some of the common offending agents, non-steroidals up on the top, COX-2 inhibitors, alcohol, sympathomimetic drugs, including the decongestants like Afrin, cocaine, stimulants often used for attention deficit disorder are listed here as well, oral contraceptives, large doses of caffeine, cyclosporin, erythropoietin, systemic corticosteroids, natural licorice, and some herbal medicines have to be checked in as well. Next slide. So some of the more uncommon causes we can't forget about, but they are rare, such as pheochromocytoma, that might present as resistant paroxysmal hypertension crises, these spells that are associated with sweating, palpitations, pallor. I would also like to mention that in that differential, you might think of panic disorder or what we used to call pseudopheochromocytoma. That also is an important historical detail. Also rare is Cushing's syndrome. Cushing's syndrome might present as a rapid weight gain, especially with central distribution, proximal muscle weakness. The test used to be to try to stand up. We'd have patients do it by a chair. You might have some appearances of the moon facies or the supraclavicular fat pads. This can be tested with an overnight 1 milligram dexamethasone suppression test or further tested by 24-hour urine-free cortisol excretion. If we go to the next slide, we're seeing a patient of mine that presented with a typical symptom pattern. In panel A is an MRI with the arrow pointing to a tumor of the right adrenal gland. This patient underwent 131 MIBG nuclear medicine imaging with a corresponding right side adrenal gland lighting up, indicating an active catecholamine producing tumor. This patient went on to surgery. The excised adrenal gland is shown in panel C. There is a large tumor with some hemorrhage inside of it, a rim of normal adrenal cortex around it, and then by number one is the residual normal adrenal gland. But that large circular fatty area is the pheochromocytoma. And then panel D shows the a typical histiocytic pattern. The area on the left-hand side corresponding to one is the normal adrenal cortex. The area number identified as number two are the abnormal chromaffin cells in a kind of polygonal spindly pattern consistent with the diagnosis of pheochromocytoma. Go to the next slide. Again, we'll wrap up with some of the more rare forms that we shouldn't forget about. There's hypothyroidism, hyperthyroidism, and primary hyperparathyroidism, which is rare, although I have to say in my clinical practice, I think I have seen hyperparathyroidism more than I've seen pheochromocytoma, the clue being patients presenting with hypercalcemia and usually a very labile pattern of blood pressures that kind of present all over the place. Again, can be diagnosed with calcium levels as well as serum parathyroid hormone. And I'm differentiating this from secondary hyperparathyroidism that might be seen with renal parenchymal disease. If we go to my next and last slide, these are again rare cases, congenital adrenal hyperplasia, that's hypertension presenting with hypokalemia, also in younger people with virilization due to an 11 beta hydroxy deficiency with incomplete masculinization in males. It can present in women as primary amenorrhea with a 17 alpha hydroxylase deficiency. This requires specific testing as outlined here in the guidelines. There are other mineralocorticoid excess syndromes other than primary hyperaldosteronism. I alluded to the one of eating primary licorice as an example. This can be also tested for. And then I've seen this maybe once in my career, patient presenting with acromegaly with the typical features of acromegaly, the acral features, enlarged shoe hat size, headaches, visual disturbances. And again, assessment of serum growth hormone can be done to assess for this. There are other rare forms of secondary hypertension that I won't get into at this talk, but I'm going to, for the sake of time, end here. And I want to thank you all again for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Diamond. And now let's welcome Dr. Vorsheimer. He's the Director of Clinical Cardiology at Montefiore Einstein Center for Heart and Vascular Care. Welcome, Doctor. Just make sure that doctor is
okay. Can you hear everybody?
Okay, you're off mute now, doctor.
Great. Okay. So first of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Phillips and Robin Vitale for including me both on the planning committee as well as on the agenda for today. What I have been asked to speak about is obstructive sleep apnea. The quote unquote often forgotten co-conspirator. And my objective here in the next 13 and a half minutes or so is to try to persuade you that perhaps that title that I was assigned is not the most appropriate one and that sleep apnea should not be the most often forgotten co-conspirator. Next slide, please. In terms of disclosures, I have none. Next slide, please. So as we think about sleep apnea from the larger perspective of the global perspective of cardiovascular disease in general, we can certainly appreciate very quickly how sleep apnea presents at the intersection between most of the major pathophysiological processes that underline cardiovascular disease: thrombosis, sympathetic system activation, intrathoracic pressure changes, and of course, endothelial dysfunction. Next slide, please. But for today, we're really going to focus exclusively on the interaction between obstructive sleep apnea and hypertension itself. And it's quite evident, and I think somewhat intuitive, that there's both the interaction between hypertension and obstructive sleep apnea, as well as the tension between the systemic processes such as age, obesity, and metabolic disturbances, and the systemic consequences of those processes in terms of the central nervous system, the cardiac function, pulmonary function, and so on and so forth. Next slide, please. So Dr. Diamond showed you this slide a moment ago. Dr. Diamond, my former fellow, we were co-fellows together at Mount Sinai and co-attendings together, both of us earlier in our career. And I think, you know, if we look at the top bar here, this is really takeaway point number one, that in most studies, if we go to the next slide, please, hypertension will occur at least 30% of patients with hypertension likely have underlying obstructive sleep apnea. In some studies, it could be as high as 80%. But I think a reasonable guess for populations such as ours here in the New York City area is a roughly 50-50 percentage of the likelihood of underlying sleep apnea. The flip side is also true, that if you take a patient with obstructive sleep apnea, at least 50% of them may ultimately have hypertension. And I think this is an important takeaway point to sort of embark upon, that we don't really need to sort of at this point go through all the data showing the epidemiological relationships and association between hypertension and sleep apnea. I think it's reasonable in the context of this talk to sort of take that as a point of embarkation, to take that as a proven point in science. Next slide, please. So what I'd rather like to do is think about how we can consider obstructive sleep apnea in our approach to the patients with hypertension. Now, typically, we don't typically see patients with obstructive sleep apnea until they come to us in the cardiovascular arena. But this is, I think, one of the most interesting observations about what happens from sleep apnea. This is nearly 2,000 patients who presented to a sleep clinic for a sleep study who were followed for nearly a decade. And what you see here is an absolute, really logarithmic gradient of the development of hypertension over the ensuing decade in patients with sleep apnea who have not yet been diagnosed with hypertension. And what you see in the bottom graph in the dark line is the relatively lower prevalence of hypertension onset in patients without sleep apnea, and a roughly doubling of that likelihood in the patients with the most severe sleep apnea. So there's really very little question, I think, at this point that sleep apnea is certainly associated, and for some of our patients, as we'll talk about, really causal for their hypertension. Next slide, please. So I think it's also important to keep in mind that the dynamic or the interaction between sleep apnea and the development of hypertension may vary in terms of the constituency and the type of population that we are seeing. Certainly, we in New York see a specific demographic in terms of socioeconomics, in terms of race and ethnic minority and ethnic background. And this was one of the more interesting studies that I think examined something that is very close to our heart, something that my friend and colleague here from Montefiore, Dr. Rodriguez, will be discussing shortly in a plenary session later in these meetings, that we all know that there are cardiovascular disease disparities at the population level. And this is perhaps one example of how that works. If you could just tap the button to advance, please, without moving to the next slide. So what you see here is the interaction between poor sleep characteristics and cardiovascular health using the AHA LifeSimple score. And what you see clearly in this slide is that whereas the p-value for the interaction between poor sleep characteristics and poor AHA cardiovascular health is highly statistically significant, that is only seen in those patients in this analysis who were either Black or of an ethnic minority. Whereas in the non-Hispanic white in the column on the right, the p-values were all non-statistically significant. And this is, I think, one sort of chip in our trying to understand how we can provide better healthcare for the various constituencies who seek our attention, particularly for hypertension and the relationship of sleep apnea. Next slide, please. This is further confirmatory evidence of the same idea. The gradient between the severity of sleep apnea and the consequences of hypertension, again, in a Black population, the Jackson Heart Sleep Study. And here again, there are two points to be taken away. In the blue bars is the patients with uncontrolled hypertension, where you see somewhat of an interaction between sleep apnea and the hypertension. But in the red bars, for resistant hypertension, which again will be one of the talks a little bit later, there's a much steeper gradient and a much clearer association between the severity of the sleep apnea and the impact on hypertension for resistant hypertension. Next slide, please. So as Dr. Diamond told you a moment ago, certainly in the academic medical centers, particularly in hypertension clinics, a great deal of time is spent speculating on potential secondary causes. And obviously, as Dr. Diamond alluded to in the previous talk, there's many endocrine and metabolic causes. But if you just look at this slide graphically depicted, there's two ways to, I think, kind of look at this slide, which is that number one, if you add up all of the other secondary causes of hypertension known to man and add them all together, they are still less frequent than obstructive sleep apnea. And ones that, as Dr. Diamond mentioned, we spend a fair amount of time searching for on a regular basis, aldosteronism, even things like pheochromocytoma, are truly an order of magnitude less frequent than obstructive sleep apnea. Obstructive sleep apnea is there for us to find. Next slide, please. So we have, I think, historically as cardiologists and primary care physicians felt that sleep apnea is really a condition that is better treated or optimally treated by sleep medicine specialists. And part of what I'm here to sort of persuade you about is that that's not necessarily true. Fortunately, in the modern world, analogous to the ambulatory blood pressure monitoring devices that we heard about earlier this morning, there are ambulatory devices that can assess for sleep apnea. This is one that we've had extensive experience with. And what you see here is that it's basically a relatively simple device that can be dispensed to the patient. It's a bracelet worn around their wrist, a clip put on their finger, and an additional bead put on their chest. Nothing on the mouth, nothing on the face, no oral appliances. Very simple to use, worn for one night, FDA approved, validated across the board, and for most of our patients, approved by insurance to obviate the need for an overnight sleep study, which obviously in the era of COVID, many patients are reluctant to consider. Next slide, please. So we heard from Dr. Diamond a moment ago and in the guidelines, the notion that perhaps we can predict obstructive sleep apnea. And I think interconnecting this next sort of point that I want to make together with the frequency in the community of obstructive sleep apnea underlying the etiology of hypertension, I think can reassure us that we don't necessarily need to focus always on that. This is data from our institution, some data that we published a number of years ago, looking at the first several hundred, 700 or 800 patients that were screened in a cardiovascular clinic, looking for for sleep apnea. We're now obviously over several thousand, looking at a simple clinical predictor that clinicians often use to predict the likelihood of obstructive sleep apnea, BMI, patient's weight, as a predictor of sleep apnea. And obviously what you see here is that the scattergram is, you know, couldn't be more random. There's absolutely no association between the patient's weight, at least in the kind of patients that we see in a cardiology practice. Next slide, please. There's a fair amount of evidence looking at various questionnaires that clinicians can employ to assist in the prediction of obstructive sleep apnea. And again, this is one particular commonly used questionnaire, the Stopp-Bang. The data is very similar for the Epworth that was referred to earlier. The sensitivity and the specificity of the questionnaires are relatively mediocre. And more importantly, the positive and especially the negative predictive value are actually not that helpful. So the bottom line is that from using standard, I think, speaking to the patient kind of questionnaires, we're not that good at predicting who has sleep apnea. So there's two ways to look at that. Obviously, one would be sort of a negative or nihilistic one, but I would argue it's the opposite. Next slide, please. Because if the prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea is roughly 50-50 in our patients with hypertension, and flipping a coin can be just as effective as subjecting them to a questionnaire, I think that empowers us to sort of proceed a little bit more aggressively with screening for sleep apnea. And we actually can identify patients who are worthy of screening. Next slide, please. Clinical variables actually do predict sleep disordered breathing. Gender, the presence of diabetes, obesity does have an interaction, and obviously a history of prior stroke as one is one simple sort of univariate analysis that is associated with a higher likelihood of sleep disordered breathing. Next slide, please. But again, going back to this most important slide, the prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea across the spectrum of cardiac disease and particularly in hypertension, if we're there 50-50, we can find it very easily. Next slide, please. So what do we do when we find it? Here's a summary of a number of analyses looking at the implications of CPAP therapy, positive airway pressure, which is the conventional treatment for obstructive sleep apnea, on blood pressure in patients with hypertension. In the light blue bars is systolic blood pressure, and the red bars is diastolic blood pressure. And overall, what we see is a fairly modest reduction, statistically significant, probably on a population basis sufficient to move the algorithm, but certainly nothing like what we would typically anticipate, let's say from a drug intervention, as was alluded to earlier by one of the first speakers. Next slide, please. At the same time, it's also important to realize that CPAP is a very heterogeneous intervention for patients. Certainly one of the main features that underlies the CPAP story in general is the issue of patient adherence and compliance, which is not that easily obtained all the time. At the same time, if one can guarantee patient compliance using the CPAP device for more than 4 hours at night, not only are more substantive reductions in blood pressure attainable, but here I think is some very encouraging evidence about target end organ damage reduction, which is reduction by echo in markers of LVH using simple two-dimensional echocardiographic monitors with substantial reductions in the severity of LVH. Next slide, please. So if we look at a meta-analysis of all of the randomized trials or most of the randomized trials in CPAP and hypertension, we can see that there is a significant reduction statistically both in systolic and diastolic blood pressure. Next slide, please. At the same time, as was alluded to before, and you saw previously, the effect is somewhat limited. So why would that be? Why is, if underlying obstructive sleep apnea is so important and so prevalent, why is the consequences of treating with CPAP so modest? I think one possibility is, in the first bullet point, that there are multiple causes for hypertension. And to the extent that other causes beyond obstructive sleep apnea are present, CPAP obviously won't have any difference. Number two, CPAP can only reverse certain intermediate mechanisms associated, but not others. So if the patient is consuming a high sodium diet, if the patient still has obesity or volume overloaded, that's not going to be important. And then the third point, which is I think the really most important point, is that all of these processes are quite chronic. And if you look only for a relatively short period of time, most of the randomized clinical trials looked for less than a year, you may not be able to reduce blood pressure in the short term. Next slide, please. At the same time, as we sort of look for specific roles where CPAP might be exceptionally effective. I think we see in resistant hypertension, such as in this trial, there are much more substantive where you can see a linear gradient between the number of hours of CPAP that are used and the reduction in blood pressure that can be achieved in systolic, diastolic, and 24-hour mean blood pressure with substantial reductions, now on the order of 10 or 12 millimeters of blood pressure achieved in the patients with so-called resistant hypertension. Next slide, please. Unfortunately, those reductions in blood pressure have not been translated into the larger spectrum of cardiovascular events. Next slide, please. This is the main study of the New England Journal, the SAVE study that was published a number of years ago, which unfortunately did not demonstrate a significant impact of the introduction of CPAP on a spectrum of cardiovascular events. Why that is has been the subject of intensive speculation and publication, largely probably related to the fact that there was not sufficient compliance with CPAP. Move on, please. Next slide. Unfortunately, that nihilism has to some degree affected the guidelines. Dr. Diamond showed you a little bit while ago, the implications for the ACC and the AHA guidelines, which is only a 2B recommendation. Next slide, please. But I would argue that if we look again at specific targets of the kind of patients that we see, for example, those patients with resistant hypertension, who are very, very common in our patient practices, we see much more effective reductions, substantial reductions in a meta-analysis, by 5 or 6 millimeters of 24-hour systolic or diastolic blood pressure, reassuring us that the introduction of CPAP for those patients is quite effective. Next slide, please. So in conclusion, although the title of our talk was obstructive sleep apnea as the often forgotten co-conspirator, please advance. I would like to suggest that that's not really right. Please advance. And if we can remember one sort of piece of data from here, it is this, that because of the prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea so commonly associated with obstructive sleep apnea and the interaction with hypertension, that a better title is perhaps considered obstructive sleep apnea as in the future, the often considered co-conspirator underlying hypertension. Next slide, please. Thank you for your attention. And I look forward to the rest of the sessions with you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Borsheimer. That was fantastic. And now let's welcome our final speaker for today, Dr. Pecker, Professor of Clinical Medicine, Division of Nephrology and Hypertension at Weill Cornell Medical College. Welcome, Dr. Pecker.
Good morning. Thank you for inviting me. I'm going to be talking today is something that's more of a niche in the area of hypertension and blood pressure control, which is the management of hypertension and orthostatic hypotension. At the Hypertension Center at Cornell, we see large numbers of patients referred to us really for hypotension and orthostatic hypotension. And we get involved with their care because hypertension frequently develops, especially supine hypertension, if it's not there originally. Next slide. Orthostatic hypotension is quite common in the population and in the, for example, in the Honolulu Heart Study of a normal aging population, I put normal in quotes here because I don't know who's normal, of normal people when they were screened at the age of 70 in their 70s, about 5% of people had were found to have significant orthostatic hypotension. With a fall of over 20 millimeters in their systolic blood pressure. And over the age of 80, it rose to about 10%. What I'm going to be focusing on here is not a quote normal aging population, but patients with neurogenic hypotension, many of whom have either Parkinson's disease, multisystem atrophy, or pure autonomic failure. These patients have been the subject of small research studies, but often have dramatic physiology that is worth paying attention to. Next slide, please. Nocturnal supine hypertension is very common in neurogenic orthostatic hypotension. It's at least 40% of patients with Parkinson's disease or multisystem atrophy. It's much greater than that in patients with pure autonomic failure, which is probably a precursor to Lewy body disease. And then of course, even if you don't have it from the disease process itself, many of the therapies that we use to raise standing blood pressure during the daytime last some time and increase supine blood pressure and create supine hypertension. This is especially true of volume expanding therapy, fludrocortisone and salt, which is sort of the foundation of most therapy for orthostatic hypotension. Several mechanisms can contribute to the low blood pressure that we see, the high blood pressure that we see it. The first and probably most important is volume expansion. We spend a lot of time volume expanding people during the day to try to maintain their upright blood pressures. And this, we pay a price for this at night. Second of all, there's residual sympathetic tone in many of these people that doesn't seem to be get turned off at night. And then third and most interesting to us in the renin world, there seems to be some sensitivity to angiotensin too. Although low plasmarenin activity is common, if not the rule, in patients with neurogenic orthostatic hypotension. Next slide, please. So how do we diagnose nocturnal supine hypertension? The first in the office, and this can take a little bit of time, but we measure supine blood pressure after about 5 minutes of rest, or the other thing that can be done is you can measure blood pressure repeatedly and wait till it levels off and see at what level it levels off to. We often ask people to measure blood pressure with home monitoring. However, this is often intrusive at night. And when you wake someone up in the middle of the night, with arousal, the blood pressure spikes as it does in the morning when we wake up. And so that I wonder often whether we're getting accurate measures when we ask people to measure their blood pressure in the middle of the night, know what's going on. Probably the most useful tool is ambulatory blood pressure monitoring, which is much less intrusive, as has been pointed out earlier. And this is a classic monitor for someone with orthostatic hypotension. You see that during the daytime, the pressures are very variable. They clearly go up at night, although they remain variable, and then they fall again on awakening. So that ambulatory monitoring is probably dramatically underutilized in high blood pressure work as a whole, but it's particularly underutilized in this population. Orthostatic hypotension is not by itself is not a reimbursable category for this test. So you have to call it labile blood pressure or something along those lines if you want insurance companies to pay for it. Next slide, please. So what are the consequences of the supine hypertension? Well, the first obvious one is hypertensive disease, heart failure with reduced ejection, with preserved ejection fraction, progression of renal disease, and proteinuria, stroke. Many of these patients are non-dippers on 24-hour blood pressure monitoring. And as was pointed out earlier, this carries a worse prognosis in patients with just routine hypertension. On the other hand, these hypertensive disease is something that occurs over long periods of time, relatively speaking, and the low blood pressure is something that will cripple someone immediately, and so that the emphasis in our practice is actually first on raising the low blood pressure and then dealing with hypertension. The second and perhaps more less well-recognized consequence of supine hypertension is what it does to sleep. Next slide, please. Supine hypertension produces a pressure naturesis with high volume nocturia and naturesis. I want you to remember that a normal person gets rid of perhaps 80% of their salt and most of their urine volume during the daytime, even though they're upright, and that sleep itself is usually antinaturetic. In patients with neurogenic orthostatic hypotension, they often have high volume nocturia, frequent, and a reversal of the pattern of urine excretion, so they get rid of more volume and more salt at night, as shown on the left and right panels of these slides. this interrupts sleep. It poses a fall risk when they get up to urinate, and their blood pressure is still orthostatic. And it worsens the morning orthostasis. These patients spend all their day retaining sodium, they spend all their night losing sodium, and they awaken with low extracellular fluid volume, which exacerbates their orthostatic hypotension. This creates, is probably a major factor in why these patients are most symptomatic in the morning. Next slide. What can you do about it? There are a number of non-pharmacologic therapies that have been proposed. The most important one by far is do not lie down. Roger Bannister, the great miler, emphasized this. neurologist and worked in this field. So you want to ask people to avoid supine posture wherever possible. During the daytime, hypertension should be treated by being upright and taking advantage of hypertensive spells to go for a walk. If they have to lie down, and frequently they do because this disease is fatiguing, a lounge chair or a Fowler position with their torso as upright as possible is useful. At the nighttime, I also ask people to elevate their torso to sleep as upright as possible. If you've ever been to Plymouth, Massachusetts, you can realize that the pilgrims slept sitting up, probably because they all drank beer and had reflux. But nevertheless, it is possible for many people to sleep relatively upright. So I recommend that people use wedges for the head of their bed to raise their entire torso, not just their mantle and neck, as you would with pillows. And it also is plausible to raise the head of the bed in many people to put put the top of the head on blocks. So you can produce, most people can tolerate up to 6 inches of reverse Trendelenburg. And this has been shown to lower blood pressure by about 10 millimeters systolic and diastolic. And also it raises the standing blood pressure in the morning. It often reduces the nocturia, and that's probably what's related to the standing, the increase in standing blood pressure in the morning. People awake and relatively volume expanded. Next slide, please. Many of these patients with orthostatic hypotension have severe postprandial hypotension. They cannot tolerate the increase in splanchnic blood flow that occurs after meals. This can be utilized when they go to bed, by asking them to eat a high carbohydrate snack before they go to bed. And this, because carbohydrate meals lower blood pressure more than high fat or high protein meals. This is an idea that's out there. It hasn't been well studied, however. But it's an easy thing to do. Next slide, please. A more recent and very creative idea has come out of Vanderbilt, where they looked at what happened when you put heating pads on people to raise their cutaneous temperature. And they found that putting a heating pad on your lower back, on your lower torso rather, and your thighs, raising it to 38 degrees, lowered blood pressure dramatically, and the blood pressure came up promptly when you decrease the heat. They found a variable effect on urine sodium excretion at night, and only the people who had the most severe, most dramatic decreases in blood pressure had this. This is something that's not been the subject of long trials, but it's a very, very interesting idea. And I wonder whether we could do better by putting the heat on the abdomen and the anteriorly so we don't heat up the kidneys, because studies in isolated animal and fused kidneys show that warming up the kidneys actually increases natriuresis. Next slide, please. The themes for pharmacologic therapy for nocturnal hypertension are, one, as I said earlier, you want to volume expand, but do it to the minimum necessary to raise upright blood pressure. I avoid shorter acting hypertensive agents, and mitodrine is the most popular one, for 4 to 6 hours before going to bed. If long-acting agents are needed during the daytime, I use long-acting agents that tend to be smoother and tend not to affect orthostatic, create orthostatic changes. And I do not use diuretics at all in this regard. Therapy that raises upright blood pressure but does not raise supine blood pressure is sort of a holy grail here. And two medicines have been proposed, which I'll talk about in a second, prutostigmine and atomoxetine. Then we also use nocturnal therapy using short-acting agents that will hopefully be gone by the morning time. And I'll go over some of these as well. Next slide, please. As you recall, the sympathetic nervous system is arranged so that the preganglionic neuron comes out of the spinal cord, and the synapse in the sympathetic ganglion is actually a cholinergic synapse. It then, the postganglionic neuron goes to the periphery, in the long postganglionic fibers, and it secretes norepinephrine. And brutostigmine, a short-acting acetylcholinesterase inhibitor, will enhance ganglionic transmission by increasing the levels of acetylcholine at the site. And it was proposed by Philip Lowe at the Mayo Clinic, and a lot of studies have shown that there are modest effects on upright blood pressure with minimal effects on supine blood pressure. Similarly, atomoxetine is a norepinephrine uptake transport inhibitor. It's marketed as Strattera. It's used for attention deficit disorder. And it will enhance transmission in the sympathetic nervous system at the postganglionic neuron. Individually, in my practice, these things have had very, very minimal effect, although occasionally it's a home run. But the Vanderbilt group, next slide, please, showed that if you combine them, as shown in these, the top bars, top graph on these slides, you get a much bigger effect than with either one alone. In fact, with either one alone, they found almost no effect. But combining them, you seem to amplify whatever residual sympathetic tone there is and raise blood pressure dramatically. The idea behind this is that since when you're lying down, there's minimal sympathetic tone, that there's nothing to amplify, so it won't affect supine blood pressure. Next slide, please. Nitroglycerin and nifedipine have been used to lower blood pressure at night. As shown on this slide, nitroglycerin goes away more quickly than nifedipine has. So short-acting calcium channel blockers are easier to use than nitroglycerin in some ways, but nitroglycerin patches, if you take them off, they will go away in about a half hour. So you can put them on when the people go to bed and take them off about a half hour before they get out of bed. As opposed to nifedipine, nitroglycerin tended to decrease the nocturia and naturesis and raise morning blood pressure as a result. Next slide. Clonidine has also been shown to be useful at night, and at least in some patients. In this slide, in this study, it was shown to be more effective than nitroglycerin, but I think that's a dosing thing and that they're probably same ideas. The major problem with nitroglycerin is that it never completely eliminates the nocturia. And if you get up with a nitrate on board and you have orthostatic hypotension, heaven help you. So I restrict the use of nitroglycerin to patients who will either use a urinal or sit at the side of the bed to urinate in the middle of the night and not make the journey to the bathroom. Next slide. Anti-renin therapy, short-acting ARBs and captopril have been used. Even in patients with low renin plasma activity, low plasma renin activity rather, as in this study, losartan was more effective than captopril in patients who have some renin, although the majority of patients will not. Captopril can be equally effective. It's interesting that losartan also decreased nocturia and urine, both in sodium and volume, but it also didn't really help morning blood pressure, perhaps because it was still in the system when people are awake. Next slide. Let me skip this and the next one in the interest of time. But the problem, next slide, please. And in the interest of the problem of baroreceptor dysfunction is a topic in and of itself. It's a hellacious thing to have to treat. And our treatments are limited. Our NYU group in the city, which is a fantastic dysautonomia group, has shown that carbidopa has some role here, but the treatment is very complex. But overall, in the treatment of orthostatic hypotension, the thing that limits people's lives is the low blood pressure. And I would emphasize that first, that's what must be treated so people can walk across a room and have a life. So I would emphasize the quality of life. You should remember that that's more important than the level of blood pressure. That most people at a level blood pressure level of 80 over 50 or a mean arterial pressure of 60 will have blood pressure to their head when they're upright. So I follow quality of life, falls, walking distance, the response to meals. And then we also obviously measure home and office blood pressure. We do 24-hour monitors as often as the situation demands. And then as a second thing, the topic of, as a secondary issue, the topic of what we talk about, I talked about here, the hypertensive disease of neurogenic orthostatic hypotension, an important, but I think a secondary issue here, which greatly complicates things. In this day and age, when people target blood pressures of 120 over 70, high blood pressure makes people very, very, very nervous. And one of the most important things I think I can do is try to put people, calm people down and put in perspective the distinctions between how low blood pressure and hypertensive disease will affect their lives in the short run, even though both are important in the long run. Thank you for your time, and I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pecker, and thank you to all of our guest speakers today. We are going to be putting a link in the chat box right now. If you click on that link, you'll be able to go back to the day one closing session. That's going to get started in just a few minutes. We encourage everyone to take a short technology break. But first, click on the link in the chat box to go back to watch the day one closing session. That'll start in just a few minutes. We want to practice our attitude of gratitude. So let's give one more thank you to our guest speakers. Of course, thank you to all of you for joining us this morning. And a thank you to our NYC Hypertension Summit presenting sponsor, Centers Healthcare, and our advocate level sponsor, Columbia University Irving Medical Center. Thank you all so much. It's been my pleasure to be your MC today, and we hope to see you at the closing session.
Ain't no valley low enough. Ain't no river wide. You live.